Today we've had this really important debate, I think, looking back at the last 10 years and looking forward to the next 10 years after the Commission on the Future of Multiethnic Britain.
10 years ago, the Runnymede Trust published its report after 2 years quite intensive work. We were dealing with extremely controversial issues, and some of them are more settled than they were, and more issues have arisen.
I had a file of hate mail, actually, you know, going back some time before this report, but my file got even thicker, you know.
Everything has changed in the last 10 years since the Parekh Report came out.
When I was reading it, there was lots that I agreed with, and there were lots of things that I didn't agree with, and I worried about how they might be put into practice.
Really, I think the panel, the commission that we gathered together, is about the best team I've been a member of. I have a picture of us in my office, as people will tell you who visited me. So it's a very proud memory. I think we achieved something worthwhile.
I thought that we clearly had a drafting problem in relation to Britishness and the post-national and so on.
The question was, who are the British in year 2000 at the turn of the century, and what does it mean to be British?
I'm not sure about the mixing bowl melting pot metaphor. I mean, that was used about the US for a long time.
The notion of a melting pot is to assimilate people. We're not either a salad bowl where you've got lots of people who are very, very distinct but don't necessarily mix very well. There probably isn't an analogy related to food that talks about what society in the UK is.
I think it would be a loss if everything kind of merged into each other. There are still elements that are reacting with each other and constantly producing something new. Someone suggested, as you remember, 10 or 15 years ago, in an argument against the melting pot theory, that it was more like a vegetable soup with big bits in it.
I think over the last 10 years, we've understood that we've got to move beyond the narrow categories that we had then. So black, white, Asian wasn't enough.
We have 300 languages spoken in London today alone, so we have a super diversity that you didn't have perhaps in the 70s and 80s.
Certainly the Olympics wouldn't have been given to us had we not emphasised our diversity. That was our winning card.
The understanding of super diversity, the understanding of the fact that there are 100,000 Brazilians in London who don't feature in any of the census categories, it's making a difference to the way our cities operate. We're now a much more diverse society, a much more confident society with that diversity. The question is, can we be a society which is inclusive of all people and benefits from that inclusivity rather than just an atomised group of people who happen to live on the same island?
What's been interesting and alarming is to see how anti-immigrant, settled black and Asian people were showing themselves. Now you ask yourself, do they feel that in order to be accepted now, to be really British, they have to be racist or anti-immigrant?
We need to have a sensible, rational debate about whether immigration can be managed, whether we can cope with the numbers, whether it's a positive thing. We don't have that debate. What we have is mudslinging.
Andrew Green is on our screens and every single day.
Migration Watch.
And lots of people will accuse him of being a racist.
We're discussing it all the time. And sorry, it's just not true.
I'm not saying that there aren't people who will argue against racism. Obviously there are. But I'm saying lots of people don't feel comfortable about saying, I'm concerned about immigration.
Right. I think we still should be cautious about assuming that the mechanics of racism, whoever they're directed to, are sort of fading away. There's too much evidence that this is not the case.
Racism is one of these, a feature of everyday life in lots of ways, but it's also a phenomenon, a social phenomenon that's changed a huge amount. I don't think we have racism as we did 20 years ago, certainly not the kind of racism I experienced when I was growing up.
I'm very concerned that we don't talk about racism nearly enough.
Do you think we talk about racism enough, Munira?
well, you know, the experience of my parents was that they experienced much more racism than I did. I don't want to use my personal subjective position as you know, comprehensive evidence, but I think that there are enough indications that racism has changed. Not to say it's completely gone, but I think that the barriers of race that would have existed 30 years ago just don't exist in the same way today.
I look at racism as a mechanism, and I look at outcomes. Who's getting the jobs? Who's getting the abuse? Who's in prison? What are the educational achievements? Not all of them are entirely to do with racism. I've been going into prisons recently to talk to Muslim male prisoners and Afro-Caribbean male prisoners, okay? And when you talk to them about their experiences as to how they're treated by prison officers, I'm sorry, there's no difference.
My view on this is that I think we've become much more sensitive about race and perhaps much more conscious about race, but that doesn't necessarily benefit or serve the greater interest.
There is, I think, a great hesitancy, a fear of saying the wrong thing, and what that does is it chills relationships between groups, actually. I think it stops white people and black people from being honest and open with each other, from discussing issues which are very sensitive.
I still think that one of the biggest things that has changed in those 10 years is the way that a lot, more in Europe, well, I don't know, I was going to say more in Europe than in Britain, but I think equally in Britain in different ways, is the way that the whole public debate, especially around Muslims, has become increasingly security-driven. You can understand why. But I think if it's not done much more carefully and much more subtly, it'll leave scars in the long term.
The problem is we cannot talk about race anymore. Because if you talk about race, it's PC gone mad. It's almost like the language, you know, nobody's a racist, even the BNP, as we know, say, I'm not a racist, but. So the meaning of the word has gone, and maybe we need a different kind of language because, as we know, everybody denies they're racist.
I think actually the opposite is happening. I think everyone is being accused of being a racist. We're all tainted by this original sin. I think there are lots of cases where people will perceive themselves to have been treated in a racist way when that might not actually be the case. There are all sorts of prejudices. There are prejudices against women, there are prejudices against people who are from a different class, people from abroad, asylum seekers. But they are not the same as the kind of racial discrimination that you would have seen in the past. You know, we have reached a situation where the good intention of anti-racism has become quite counterproductive, I think.
I think you're right on that people should be able to have conversations. But that's not the same as saying everybody's talking about racism, because they're not. I mean, people, you know, every time anybody complains about this is the... I completely agree with you that people should not be afraid of asking the difficult questions. And there is a very artificial conversation going on between people. And we need to make it a much more engaged and actually difficult conversation, because if we're going to live together, we're going to have to talk to each other in a much more honest way. I agree with you. But I don't know where these conversations about racism are going on.
You asked us all if we wrote the report today, would we focus on race? You know, the one ethnic group that wasn't included in 2000 was the white working class. You might argue that maybe race is not the defining feature of inequality.
I think that it would have been different, and we assumed that the sociological processes of integration were doing their work and didn't require much interference. What required intervention was equality. And that was perhaps just a little bit too complacent on our part. I think that in the tone of the report, we took commonality more or less for granted. We just thought, well, yes, it'll work out. And I think that post those disturbances and post 9/11, we wouldn't have just taken it for granted. We would have written it up more strongly.
I think there's the panel showed the breadth of opinion, but also retreated very quickly to this notion that it's too complicated. I want to understand what is simple that people can actually motivate themselves around in challenging race inequality and making sure that we benefit from the ethnic diversity that we have in our society. Runnymede is growing. Runnymede is seeking to make sure these debates happen at the centre of our political discussions, but also discerning from those discussions what the key issues are that politicians, the people in positions of power, need to respond to as well.